So today's topic is directly abstract simplicial complexes. Abstract simplicial complexes. Last time we introduced some affine geometry. Let me, before going to abstract simplicial complexes, one or two more concepts from affine geometry, let us cover that and then come to affine, this abstract simplicial complexes. So here is this theorem was done. Here is a definition. The convex combination of these points, endpoints inside RD, it is an affine combination, lambda xi, summation lambda equal to 1. But one more condition, each lambda I must be positive, non-negative also. Automatically, each lambda I will be less than or equal to 1 also, because sum total is 1. So such a thing is called convex combination. Just like 0 less than or equal to t less than or equal to 1, I have been taking t times p plus 1 minus t times q. Okay, there it is convex combination of only two elements. But here you could take any finite set, then you can talk about convex combination. The convex hull is set of all convex combinations. Take set any edge, then you can take convex hull of that. It is called a convex con of M. That is the notation. It is automatically a subset of FM, affine M. Here, all linear combinations are taken without lambda I greater than equal to 0. This condition is not there. Okay. So a subset A of R is said to be convex if convex hull of A itself is equal to A. This is similar to what in topology, something is closed, its closure is equal to A. It's like that. What is the meaning of that? If you take a convex combination of finite many points of A, it is again inside A. It is similar to FM, affine subspaces. Okay, only convex subsets here. So line segment is a convex set, not a line. Similarly, the inside of a triangle, full, not just the boundary triangle, inside of a triangle is a convex set. Tetrahedron is convex. These are our standard convex sets. Okay, there are many. Even a square is a convex set. Right? So you will see that we are concentrating on particular kind of convex sets soon. Okay, so this is what is called a geometric and simplex. Geometric and simplex. So, by the very name, you may anticipate that there is going to be something n simplex also without that the tag geometric. So, what is geometric n simplex? It means convex hull of any n plus 1 affinely independent points v1, v2, vn plus 1 in RD. The elements of Vi are called vertices of the simplex. The number n is called the dimension of this A. So A is a convex hull of v1, v2, vn plus 1. V1, v2, vn plus 1 must be affinely independent. Then we call it as geometric and simplex. A zero simplex is nothing but a single point. To take one single point, what is its affine combination? Lambda times x, where summation lambda must be 1. No, so it is just lambda is 1. So it is just x itself. So its convex combination is also one point. Okay. And a one simplex is a line segment. And a two simplex, a triangle. A three simplex, a tetrahedron. These are names. Afterwards, we don't know what to do. The four simplex, I don't know what name I should give. So we just go n simplex. Okay, note that every element of A, unique combination of these vertices, unique linear, unique convex combination. Okay, so uniqueness follows because of affine independence of v1, v2, vn. If ti times vi equal to summation si times vi in two different ways, then what you will get is si minus ti times vi will be zero, which at least one of the si minus ti will not be equal to zero. Sum total of si minus ti is equal to sum total of si plus sum minus sum total of vi, which is one. So that will give you that vi's are not affinely independent. Therefore, uniqueness follows. It is exactly similar to whenever you have a linearly independent set, then every element in the linear span of these sets is a unique linear combination of these the n elements there. So that is called a basis there, right? Here, these vi's are called vertices. There is one very special point, you know, by symmetry. What is it? It is summation vi divided by n plus 1. There are n plus 1 points here. So I am dividing by n plus 1 after taking a summation. So this is a convex combination, and this point is called the barycenter of A. Okay. You may call it centroid also. Okay. There are lots of centers, not in plane geometry. Right? Ortho center, in center, and so on, various centers. We have just barycenter will do. This barycenter is called, some people call it centroid also, no problem. Here is an easy theorem. Let A and B be any two geometric simplices. Okay? There exists an affine isomorphism from A to B such that FA equal to B, and A and B are isomorphic in that sense, affine isomorphism. If and only if dimension of A equal to dimension of B. So just the dimension will tell you that they are affinely isomorphic. Okay? So this is the starting point, maybe you can say, that, you know, the topology here is reduced to combinatorics, finite geometry. So this is the starting point of that. So you will see more and more of this kind. Let us see how to prove. Suppose dimensions are the same. Choose some labeling, that means number of vertices are the same, right? A1, A2, AK, and B1, B2, BK. Dimension here, it will be actually equal to K is the dimension of A plus 1, one more. That means number. That's what we have seen the dimension by definition. Take F of AI equal to BI. It's a 1-1 correspondence of vertices. Choose any 1-1 correspondence. Okay. Extends it linearly over, extend it linearly means what now? Affine linearly. Lambda I AI summation will go to lambda I BI summation. That's all. Just like in linear algebra. Okay. Once you have defined it over basis elements, it is uniquely defined in the linear algebra, exactly here also. It's uniquely defined because each lambda AI has unique expression. Okay. So that will give you an isomorphism. Conversely, if A to B is an isomorphism, then AIs are affinely independent. F of AI should be affinely independent. Similarly, F inverse of BI should be affinely independent. Therefore, the dimension of A, that the K and L, they must be the same. Okay, so this is all missing. Last time we couldn't do it, so I have done it. Now we will directly take up the study of abstract simplicial complexes, which does not look like any topology at all, you will see now. Okay, so you have to hold your horse for a while to see the topology behind them. All right. So I'll directly start with the definition of abstract simplicial complex. It will consist of a set denoted by V and called as vertex set, and another set denoted by S called what is finite collection of subsets, simplices. Okay, I will write down this one later on. S is a collection of finite subsets of V. Okay, it satisfies only two of the conditions. Namely, for every V inside V, the singleton is inside S. Remember, elements of S are subsets of V. Okay, so I should not write V inside S, but I should write singleton V inside S. Whenever F is a subset belonging to S, all subsets of F will be also inside S. In other words, S is closed under taking subsets. Okay, so these are the only two conditions that will make a simplicial complex. So let us go on to some more definitions and properties. Elements of V are called vertices of K. Those of S are called simplices of K. If F is inside S, number of points, namely cardinality of F, say equal to Q plus 1, then F is called a Q simplex. Okay, and you can also say dimension of F is Q. So this is the definition of dimension. Guess the number of points minus 1. Thus, the vertices of K are all zero simplexes of K. You take a vertex, put it inside a bracket to make it a singleton, it will become a zero simplex. So soon, we will have this liberty of not writing the bracket, that's all. Like we write sometimes V minus zero, where V minus singleton zero. So some set theory, we take that kind of liberty, no? So only that liberty is there, that's all. Thus, vertices of K are zero simplices, okay? So as a vertex, they are elements of V, but as elements of S, it is a singleton Vs which are inside S. That is the difference between logically what it is. But you can say that these vertices also zero faces. Okay. So if F prime is contained inside F and F itself is in S, then we say that F prime is a face of F. A face, here it may be equality also. Okay. So for example, if you take one vertex here, the singleton singleton V will be a face. So all subsets are called faces. Often a simplex is described by enumerating its zero spaces. Enumerating zero faces means what? Just writing down the set, that's all. What are the elements of that set? Just write down automatically all the subsets are there, is there, you have to think about it, that's all. This is just like writing when you have topology, you just write down sub-basic open sets only. then the topology is understood. Observe that we have followed allowed empty subset also as simplex. I never said F is not empty. Okay, empty set is also allowed. What is the dimension of empty set? There are no elements there. So cardinality is zero. Then I have to subtract one. So the dimension is by definition minus one. Okay. Finally, whenever the vertex set itself is finite, then automatically S will be also finite because it's only finite subsets of a finite set, right? Therefore, that will be also finite. So K itself is called a finite simplicial component. The vertex set must be finite. So these are just some names. I will keep reminding you again and again. So soon you will get used to this. Now, I can assign the dimension to the whole of K. The K is an imperial complex. So what is this dimension? It is the supremum of all n, where n is what? Some simplex or dimension of some simplex in K. Suppose there is a simplex of dimension n, then dimension of K will be at least n. So I have to take the supremum. This supremum could be infinite. If there is a simplex of dimension n for every n, then dimension of K will be infinite. If it's finite means, okay, say K, what is that dimension? There is at least one simplex of that dimension, and all other simplexes are of dimension less than or equal to that n. Which is the supremum, is finite. The finiteness of K, dimension is K, does not mean that K is finite. But if K itself is finite, then the dimension has to be automatically finite. Okay, if the dimension of K is finite, then there are simplices in K of dimension n, and all simplices of dimension are, these are maximal. Maximal means what? You can't have another simplex containing that. If n simplex containing that, the dimension would have increased, right? So these simplices will be maximal, which means all other simplices are subsets of simplices of dimension n. Okay, not all maximal simplices need be of the same dimension. Remember, I can have a singleton zero, singleton say one here, and then a simplex somewhere. Okay, both will be maximal. Dimension will be one here, but this singleton zero standing away, that will have dimension zero. Okay. So whenever everything is contained in an n simplex, such a simplex is called pure. These things are very, very important in algebra and combinatorial mathematics. But for us, this will not play much role. Okay. So you can soon forget about this one. Perhaps I am never going to use this word pure. Simplicial map phi. You see, now we have introduced the definition of simplicial complex. Okay, now we want to introduce the notion of what is the map between them. Like topological spaces, there's a continuous map. If there are groups, there is homomorphisms and so on. So you should have relations also. What kind of functions are allowed here? So take a simplicial map from K1 to K1 means what? Okay. So K1 itself has in a structure of K1 means what? It has a V1, a vertex, and S1, a set of simplices, right? So the function phi corresponds to actually a function from, set theory function from vertex set V1 to vertex set V2. Okay, with an additional hypothesis on that condition that each simplex F inside K1, phi of F makes sense because phi is a function of V1, so phi of F makes sense. This is a subset of V2, it must be inside K2 means what? It's a simplex in K2, it must be inside S2. F belongs to S1. Means phi of belongs to S2. Okay, so that is the condition. Image of every simplex must be a simplex. It need not be of the same dimension. Number of elements in F may be say 5. Number of elements in phi F may be 4. It cannot be more than 4. We know. More than 5 we know. Okay, it may be 4. It may be 3, it may be 2 also. But phi being function, it will not be empty. That's all. If F itself is empty, phi empty will be empty. There is no problem. Okay. So usual set theoretic composition of functions, phi from V1 to V2, another one, say psi from V2 to V3, then psi composite phi makes sense. Automatically, it will be simplicial because psi of VF, this is a simplex, must be a simplex inside S3. Okay, so composition of simplicial maps is a simplicial map. Identity map from K to K, namely vertex to vertex, is a simplicial map. No problem. Okay. What is the meaning of simplicial isomorphism? Simplicial isomorphism is first of all a bijection on the vertex sets. That means there is an inverse vertex set. The inverse must be also a simplicial map. Inverse must be a simplicial map. Okay. A bijection of vertex sets. Okay. Need not be an isomorphism, even if it is a simplicial map. The inverse may not be simplicial. So this is strangely typical of topology. A continuous bijection may not be a homeomorphism. The inverse may not be continuous. Whereas in linear algebra, we have a linear bijection. Inverse is automatically linear. In group theory, if you have a linear, if you have group homomorphism, it is a bijection. The inverse is automatically a group homomorphism. Okay. So, though this is like combinatorics, this is like algebra, it is more close to topology in this nature. Inverse has to be, you have to demand that inverse is also a simplicial map for an isomorphism. Some more terminologies. What is the meaning of a subcomplex? Subcomplex K prime. Say V prime, S prime of a simplicial complex K. Okay, we will just denote it by K prime sub of K. So, what is the meaning of this? The set vertex set V prime must be a subset of V, and S prime must be a subset of S. Okay. K prime itself must be a simplicial complex on its own, first of all. And these inclusions must be valid. Then only you call it a subcomplex. What is the meaning of this? The vertex set must be finite, must be a subset of the original set V. Whenever you have simplex inside K prime, it must be a simplex inside K also. So that is the meaning of that. All the vertices of V prime, okay, are inside V. You may, for example, take all the vertices of V equal to V prime. But suppose some of the faces in S are missing here. That is way of taking a subcomplex. It will be subcomplex. Some of them are missing, but whatever you have taken, they are inside S. You don't take a new simplexes. Okay, so that will be subcomplex. Note that in this situation, the inclusion map K prime to K is a simplicial map, because every simplex in K prime is a simplex here, and the map is inclusion. Phi is inclusion map here. Okay. So I recall K prime itself is a simplicial complex. Okay. By subcomplex, simplicial complex, you know, we mean a simplicial complex K prime. What is the meaning of this? 1 and 2 must be satisfied. That whenever, actually, number 2 is most important. Whenever, say, F is in K prime and F prime is a subset of F, all that F prime must be also in K prime. That must be automatically here. So you can't say that you keep one subset here and miss a subset of that set. That should not happen. All right, so let us run through a few of examples now. I may not be able to do all of them. Take any set, okay? Then take the collection of all finite subsets of that. S is all finite subsets. So that is a simplicial complex. So this corresponds to, like, we take, you know, in topology, what do we do? We take a set and then take all subsets, right? That's a discrete, right? You are taking all subsets here, which are finite, of course, because we are not allowed to take infinite subsets. All finite subsets to take. So that is a simplicial complex. This simplicial complex contains, as subcomplexes, all simplicial complexes whose vertex set is a subset of V. You can't have anything better than that. That is why I told you that this is like a discrete space. Okay. In logic, it is discrete, but you will see that topology later on, it is the opposite. The isomorphism type of this simplicial complex depends only on the cardinality of V. Okay. I just take V and I just take W. If the cardinalities are the same, then taking all subsets here, taking all subsets here, there will be a corresponding isomorphism. All that I have to do is write down a bijection of the vertices. That's all. Take any bijection of the vertices, it will be a simplicial isomorphism.
The dimension would be 1 plus cardinality of V, right?
Dimension of S of this K.
Yes.
Dimension of this K could be infinite. Depends upon what is V. Suppose V is infinite set. Then I can go on taking finite subsets. You see, if V is a finite set, suppose there are only n elements, then the dimension will be n minus 1. Okay. If it's infinite, the dimension of this simple shell complex will be infinite.
Yes, sir.
Each simplex is finite, finite dimension, but dimension of K is infinite. Let's go to a second example. Consider a special case where V itself is finite. That's what we are discussing, right? With n plus 1 elements. This is a very important one for us. Now, what are you taking? You are taking n plus 1 element set, then you are taking all subsets, empty set, then all the singletons, then all the doubletons, all the tripletons, and so on. You are taking. Okay? Yes or no?
Yes, yes, sir.
This, yes. This is now characteristic of our, what we are calling that standard n simplex. What we do? Take the basic unit vectors E1, E2, En plus 1 inside Rn plus 1. Okay. We denote this corresponding simple shell complex by the simple delta n. Now I am giving you another specific case. Instead of arbitrary set V, I am taking V to be E1, E2, En plus 1. Okay. Then take all subsets of even into n plus 1. That simple shell complex we are denoting by delta n without the bars. Convex combination, remember, convex combination of this set was denoted by mod delta n. So soon we will understand what is the difference between these two symbols, okay? Right? So this overuse of the same symbol is deliberate because they are very closely related. So you have to hold your horses till what is the difference between them. What I want to say is, again I repeat, take any simple shell complex with this property, namely n plus 1 points, and then all subsets. They are all isomorphic to this delta n. Because our previous thing here, this remark is applicable here also. Take any bijection of the vertex set, that will give you an isomorphism. So up to isomorphism, an n simplex, okay, the delta n is unique. Okay, there is a single one. Any simple shell complex of finite dimension can be described by declaring all maximal simplices in it. Okay? If it's infinite dimension, there is no maximal. So that's it. You can do it only for finite dimension case. Look at what are all the maximal simplexes. I will give you a list of them. Rest of them, you can know what are the other simplices. They are subsets of this, that's all. In fact, all subsets of whatever I have given you, they must be there. So this is an easy way of, you know, programming a computer for a simple shell complex. You just declare what is the rule for simple shell complexes, it understands. Then you give the list of maximal simplices, over. Okay. So this is especially effective while describing a finite simple shell complex. We need to merely list all maximal simplices. If F is a simplex of a simple shell complex, then the set of all faces of F, okay, just only take the faces of F, including F itself. That itself will be a subcomplex. Okay, that subcomplex also we will denote by F. This is just like when you have a subset of a topological space X, then you write the subspace also by that symbol, same symbol, no? But what is the subspace? It consists of all those open sets inside X intersection with A. You intersect with A, that is the collection of open subsets of R A. You don't keep on writing that, right? So that is like that. So denoted by F itself, okay? A set of all proper faces of F, which means F excluded, that will be also a subcomplex. Just the biggest one, the F is not there, but rest of them are there, that is a subcomplex again, right? So that will be denoted by BF, B corresponding to the boundary. For example, suppose I take a three simplex. A three simplex is a tetrahedron. Okay. If I take the boundary, namely the tetrahedron itself is not taken, all its subsets are taken. What do I get? All the four triangles I will come. So they form the boundary of the tetrahedron. If you take a simplex, one simplex, what will be its boundary? It will consist of just two singletons, which are the boundary points.
So it is like removing the interior.
Yeah, no, but we should not speak of that yet because we haven't given any topology.
Okay.
Yeah, we are removing the whole simplex. The simplex is V1, V2, the subset. It's a subcomplex. It's a faces are singleton V0, singleton V1. Okay. I am just justifying the name for boundary of F. Okay. For this, you can look at the copy of this one, namely the standard simplex. What was the standard simplex? It was the line joining delta one, line joining that one. So there you have the topology, right? Though we haven't given topology for all the simplicial complex. That's why I have brought this delta n and mod delta n. Okay. The motivation is geometric, but definitions are all abstract.
Yes, sir.
If the dimension of F is n, okay, then F is a carbon copy of delta n. I'm just repeating the same thing, that F is isomorphic to delta n. This should already justify to some extent the claim that simplicial complexes delta n's, delta 1, delta 2, delta 3 and so on, are the building blocks of simplicial complex. Because each simplex there is just a copy of delta n. That n will depend upon the dimension, that's all. Okay. I think I will stop here. Next time we will do some more examples. Thank you.